Okay, so we are going to get started. Welcome all to the workshop on cosmic expansion and the evidence from the JWST and other recent observations. So we are going to have a fairly tight schedule, so we should get started. Our first speaker is Martin Lopez-Corredoira, and he's going to speak about tests for the expansion of the universe. And the format here is we are going to have 25-minute presentations with 5 minutes for questions. And then we are going to have a 15-minute break after the first four presentations. And then after the final two presentations, we're going to have 45 minutes for discussion among the panelists, and then 45 minutes for discussion from the audience. So this is, as far as I know, the first discussion of this subject since the JWST data has become available. So why don't you go ahead and maximize, Martin, and start your presentation?
Thank you, Eric, for the invitation, and everybody for coming here to attend to this presentation. The topic of the expansion of the universe, as everybody of you know, is one of the fundamental ideas in cosmology nowadays, in the standard model and also in other alternative models. Most cosmologists, I would say everybody among mainstream cosmologists and most of others, believe that expansion is a fact, is an undiscussable fact. However, there are no direct evidences of the expansion. If we ask an astrophysicist if you could observe a galaxy increasing the distance from us, that is the direct evidence for the recession of the galaxies, the answer is clearly not. We cannot observe the recession of the galaxies from us because this is very slow. It's impossible to measure it. For instance, in one century, we'll expect the distance of a galaxy to vary only 0.0000007% of the distance. So it's something totally negligible. It's impossible to measure how the galaxies get away from us directly. So there is no direct evidence of this recession. This number is very small because of the value of the Hubble constant that indicates that the recession is very small. A value of 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec means 77,000 kilometers per hour each million light years. And since 1 million light year is around 9.5, 10 to 18 kilometers, you can compare that 10 to 18 kilometers is much, much larger than 70,000 kilometers. So we need many, many hours. Indeed, we need the life of the universe to get this distance, this variation of this distance. In one century or even in few thousands of years, the motion of the galaxy is almost negligible. We cannot observe directly the recession of the galaxies if it exists. We have to look for other arguments. From the theoretical point of view, we cannot reject directly the expansion because even a static universe is compatible with general relativity. We know it. Einstein proposes the first model, the first cosmological model in 1917, introducing the cosmological constant to avoid the collapse of the universe in the context of general relativity. Other problems such as the stability or the Olbers paradox in an infinite universe, well, these are more difficult to solve, but even there is literature discussing the possibility to keep a static universe and even in a relativistic context to solve these kinds of problems. So from the theoretical, purely theoretical point of view, we cannot exclude a universe which is static. Of course, everybody knows that the most important argument in favor of the expansion of the universe is the redshift of the galaxies, that the redshifts are more or less proportional to the distance. And this is well explained by universe in expansion, as was proposed by Lemaître in 1927 and later by Hubble 1929. And many other cosmologists have agreed that this is the right interpretation. We have to bear in mind that even Hubble has some doubts about the validity of the redshift, as I explain here in this quotations. For instance, it seems likely that redshifts may not be due to an expanding universe, and much of the speculation on the structure of the universe may require re-examination, was said by Hubble in 1947. Sandisk has made similar observations about the life of Hubble in the last years. So it's curious that the person who was more important in the discovery, this putative discovery of the expansion of the universe, even had doubts. The reason for these doubts, most of you know, is that there are alternative ideas to explain the redshift of the galaxies. Instead of the expansion of the universe, instead of the cosmological redshift, there is, for instance, the explanation of the tired light hypothesis, consisting in the fact that the photons lose some energy in their travel in the intergalactic medium. So in the path between the galaxy and us, the photon can have some kind of interaction and lose some energy, being the energy loss proportional to the length of the path. This is the idea behind the tired light hypothesis, proposed in the same year in which Hubble proposed the expansion of the universe, in 1929, by Zwicky. We know this idea has some problems because we don't know any kinds of interaction, any kind of scattering between the photons and some other kinds of particles that has the necessary characteristics to explain the redshift. For instance, all the kinds of scatterings produce some variation of the direction of the photon, and this will be translated into a blurring in the images. We don't see the blurring in high redshift galaxies, so we suppose that the direction of the photon, in case there is a tired light effect, should keep the same without variation. Also, the dependence on the frequency, etc. There is a large number of papers and books during many decades discussing the possibility of introducing, in many cases, some exotic physics to solve these problems and to keep some tired light mechanism. But at present, it's just a speculation. Also, some decades ago was remarkable the tension, the problem of the anomalous redshifts. Some astrophysicists have claimed that there are some objects with different redshifts, and apparently they are connected. Apparently, this is the controversy, whether the connection is real or not. Here I put the example, for instance, of Markarian 205 and the galaxy that have very, very different redshifts. If they have different redshifts, they should have different distance. So there is something that we could not understand in these kinds of systems. Most of the cosmologists claim that this is just a coincidence and this is a projection of objects that are at different distance. But even so, there are some statistical problems to be solved here. The case is that with the redshift itself, with the idea that we have a cosmological redshift, perhaps it's the best explanation. The best explanation is that we have a universe in expansion. It's a good hypothesis to explain the redshift of the galaxy, but it's not a direct evidence. We need something else to demonstrate the reality of the expansion of the universe. And this is what I want to talk, which is the test for the expanding universe, the indirect test, not the direct. Directly, we cannot check the recession of the galaxy, but the indirect test. Perhaps one of the most important tests was the redshift drift, but unfortunately it was never carried out because of the difficulty to carry out these kinds of tests. Sandisk in the year 1962 proposed to observe the variation of the redshift of the galaxy with time, not only the variation of the distance that I have said, which is very difficult, but the variation of the velocity. However, this variation is so small, we are talking about a few centimeters per second in 1 year, that we will need observation and 4,000 hours of observing time just to carry out this test. So possibly it will be something for the future, but at present it's not feasible. Moreover, possibly even if we are able to reach this resolution for the spectra of 1 centimeter per second, which is very, very low, we have possibly many systematic errors due to the motions of the galaxies, the quasars, etc. So in practice, this will be very difficult to carry out in the future, even with the best of the technology. There are nonetheless some tests, many tests in the literature that have tried to provide some indirect proof in favor of the expansion or against the expansion in favor of a static universe. Here I list perhaps the most important tests that are available in the literature that I have compiled in the book that I published recently. I have put here a list with 9 different tests. From this test, only the first two are, I would say, good arguments in favor of the expansion. The first one is the temperature of the CMB as a function of redshift. It is clear now that there is a variation of this temperature. It is 2.7 Kelvin in the locally, in the radiation of the CMB. But if we go to systems at high redshift, it evolves as proportional to 1 plus Z, as is expected by universe in expansion. I have not much time to talk about the CMB, but well, you can read in the literature that this is perhaps one of the better arguments in favor of the expansion, the variation of the CMB temperature with the redshift. The second one that I will say is a very good argument is the time dilation. The fact that the periodicity, the periods of some variable objects with variable luminosity, this periodicity also changes with redshift of the observed object with a factor 1 plus Z also. And this is due to the expansion of the universe because the emitting object is receding from us, so there is a delay in the arrival of the photons with respect to the times in which it was emitted. So if some object has a periodicity of 10 days at redshift 1, when it arrives to us, we'll have a periodicity of 20 days. This delay is due to the expansion motion. This is a very good argument, in my opinion, in favor of the expansion. All the rest of the tests that I put here are, I would say, controversial. And even in some cases, they can be some tests more in favor of the static universe. For instance, the Tolman test or the angular size test, as I will explain later. However, we have a problem here. Even if it is the fits are very good with the static universe, we cannot reject definitively the idea of expansion of universe because this test depends also on the evolution of galaxies. There is a degeneracy of solutions, and we cannot separate the evolution of the galaxies from the cosmological parameters. So these tests are not clean tests. They cannot separate. We have also last one, the Alco-Pasinsky, which is independent of the evolution of the galaxies, but is compatible with both. This was the situation of the test of the expansion of the universe 3 years ago. Now I will refer to some few papers that have been published more recently, which, in my opinion, they do not produce something very relevant. The situation is still the same than 3 years ago. I will start with the time dilation. The time dilation was very good the fit with supernova, but some years ago we thought that the quasars could not produce this time dilation. This year, here I put some reference of the time dilation. The original reference is Wilson for the time dilation test. This year, as I said, it was published a paper by Luis and Brewer that, if it is correct, they show that there is a time dilation for quasars too. The periodicity in the quasar is multiplied by a factor 1 plus Z with a power with an exponent n up to n. And the value of n is compatible with 1, which is what is expected in a expanding universe. So this apparently is something in favor of the expanding universe. About other tests that are usual for discussing the expansion or the static universe. One of them is the Hubble-Lemaitre diagram. That we know that for galaxies is maybe better with the static universe, but however, it is clear that with supernova, we know very well the Hubble-Lemaitre diagram for supernova is very well fitted with the Lambda CDM model. Even indeed, the dark energy was introduced ad hoc in order to fit this data precisely. Nothing very relevant was produced in the last year. However, it is something remarkable that the static universes are not rejected with this test. We can produce a fit of the supernova with a static universe just introducing some small extinction or some small evolution in the supernova. So the supernova are not perfect standard candles. And this small amount of extinction or a small amount of evolution is compatible with our knowledge of supernova in the local universe. So the conclusion is that there is no conclusion. Hubble diagram is not saying nothing against the static universes or expanding universes. Another test is the galaxy number counts, which was used many times in the last decades. Here I show one of the last papers published about this test by La Violet, the 2021, in which he shows with more recent data that still nowadays the Tired Light model is perhaps the best model to fit the data of the galaxy counts if we don't include any evolution of the galaxies. The Lambda CDM is a little bit worse. We need to include the dark energy, of course, in order to get a better fit. But even so, it's a little bit worse. And this difference between the theory and the data can be solved using the evolution of galaxies. So again, this is not conclusive. We cannot conclude whether there is expansion or not only looking at this diagram, because the evolution of galaxies is always a piece that an element with which we can play just to fit the data. Sorry. The other classical test is the angular size test. The idea is very simple. If we have objects with the same size, a galaxy with the same mass or same luminosity should have the same size. Imagine that. Then if the galaxy is at larger distance, you will have lower angular size. And the angular size in a static universe with Euclidean geometry is inversely proportional to the distance or to the redshift. This test was carried out many times, but now with the last results of the James Webb telescope, precisely we can reach much higher redshift, even redshift up to 10. And we confirmed the trend that was investigated in the past, that was shown in the past. We confirmed that the Lambda CDM is not fitting the data of the angular size test. And the difference is quite remarkable. It's quite remarkable. We have at redshift almost 10, we have a factor of 10. The Tired Light model, or even the static model with linear Hubble law, fits much better. The question here is that, of course, we have to admit that this is a point in favor of the static universe, but we cannot reject the expansion of the universe only looking at this diagram. We cannot reject because there is the possibility that there is some evolution of the galaxies, of the galaxy size. Is problematic this evolution? Yes, we know, because the mechanisms to make the galaxy so small, we are talking about a galaxy 10 times smaller in size, which means that the density, the matter density and the stellar density should be 1,000 larger than in the local universe. We can imagine a galaxy like the Milky Way compressed in a size of 1 or 2 kiloparsecs. This is crazy, this idea that we can have a galaxy with 10 up to 11 solar masses within 1 kiloparsec. It's like the density of a globular cluster. All the mechanisms that we know for the formation of the galaxies and early type galaxies, or the evolution of the mass luminosity ratio, the merger ratio, the massive outflows, all these mechanisms have been taken into account, and is not enough to justify such a huge increase of the size of the galaxy. So one of the two options: either we have a problem with the cosmological model and there is no lambda CDM is incorrect, or we don't understand many things about the evolution of, and formation of the galaxy. There is a serious problem there. Nonetheless, as I say, well, still evolution in size is just a possibility to save the cosmology and to save the expansion of the universe. Something very similar happens with this test, the distant duality test, in which is the ratio between the luminosity distance and the angular distance, which is much more in favor of the static universe. The static universe predicts a dependence proportional to 1 plus z. And the lambda CDM, the expanding universe in general, is 1 plus z up to 2, 1 plus z squared, the dashed line. We see the points fit much better the static universe. Nonetheless, again, we have the solution of introducing some kind of coincidence of in the evolution of galaxies, in this case, in the luminosity and the size of the galaxies, in order to compensate this difference between the theory and the points. The question is there any test that is independent on the evolution of the galaxies? Because we always have the problem of the evolution of the galaxies as a possible solution to save the expansion of the universe. Is there anything that we can do in large scale structure to independent of the evolution of the galaxies? There is such a test. This is called the Alcock-Paczynski test. It's a test that was proposed in the 70s by these two astrophysicists, Alcock and Paczynski, and consists in measuring the distance of an object with a spherical symmetry, both along the line of sight and perpendicular to the line of sight. The ratio between these two distances is only dependent on the cosmological model, assuming there is a spherical symmetry. We can assume a spherical symmetry, for instance, in the two-point correlation, in the distribution of galaxies, there is a spherical symmetry. And this is totally independent on the evolution of galaxies, because the sphericity does not have any evolution with the residue. So it's a very important tool to investigate the cosmological test, because this ratio between the distance along the line of sight and perpendicular to the line of sight depends only exclusively on the cosmological model. Also, other corrections, but does not depend on the evolution, at least, is what I mean. The last time we have carried out this kind of test, I have published with Fulvio Melia recently a paper last year. We could see that, unfortunately, the data nowadays are not good enough to carry out a precise test. But maybe in the future it will be possible. We see here that with some of the last data of Sloan 4, we can reach a resif up to 2.5, more or less, measuring quasars and galaxies using the baryonic acoustic oscillation. It's important to use this baryonic acoustic oscillation because we avoid some possible bias of the resif distortion. I will not enter into it's a technical question. But the thing is that with this data of the bow peak, it's possible to measure the geometry of the universe. The thing is that nowadays the error bars are still quite large, and we have no data at a very large redshift. Maximum we have reached is 2.5. And with this data, we cannot exclude neither the expansion nor the static universe. Both of them are compatible with the data within 1 or 2 sigma. These examples are tests of the expansion of the universe directly. Of course, we can imagine other kinds of tests or problems related with the standard model, with the lambda CDN, and the, some of the characteristics of the high-resif universe proposed by the lambda CDN, although these are not directly connected with the expansion. Perhaps the most important problem nowadays with the lambda CDN model, and this is a problem that we know since more than 10 or 20 years ago, is that there are many massive galaxies at high resif, much more than what is explained by the lambda CDN. Here, for instance, this paper by Steinhardt some years ago shows very clearly that we have the abundance, the density of very massive galaxies at high resif is much, much larger than what is predicted by the model. This is what is called the impossibly early galaxy problem. Nowadays, with the last data of the James Webb Telescope, there are, of course, new evidence in the same direction at higher resif. But the problem has not changed. Indeed, we know that we have a problem. We knew we had this problem 10 or 20 years ago, and the problem is still there. The only thing that we have increased the resif of the galaxies that we can reach with this very expensive device. By the way, you know the price of the James Webb Telescope was around $10 billion, which is with a high difference the most expensive instrument for astronomy ever built, and possibly one of the most expensive for fundamental science at the same level of the particle accelerators. I have no time to review all the literature, and there are now hundreds of papers with the data of the James Webb. Perhaps one of the most remarkable, in my opinion, was the one published this year by the group of Labbé, indicating that there are what we already know, but at high resif, where there are very massive galaxies at resif 8. Here, Labbé indicates that this is a serious problem for the Big Bang cosmology. If we confirm the resif of these galaxies, that at the beginning they were measured photometrically, we have to say that at least from these six massive galaxies, two of them have been confirmed spectroscopically more recently, a few months ago. So apparently there is not a problem with the determination of the photometric resif here. Even it's not only the problem, it's not only the question of the mass of the galaxy. The problem is also how much time do we need for the formation of these massive galaxies. According to some determinations of the age of the galaxies, using the Balmer break in the spectral energy distribution of these galaxies, these galaxies produced by Labbé and some others have a Balmer break corresponding to galaxies older than the universe. So it's most likely, even the error bars are quite big, but most likely these galaxies have ages larger than 0.6 gigayears, which is the age of the universe at resif 8, something which is a serious tension with the lambda CDN, although not necessarily means that there is no expansion. Possibly there are other cosmological models with expansion, but with different age of the universe. We already know also that there are plenty of new galaxies discovered by the James Webb, some of them up to resif 16, 17. Not confirmed spectroscopically all of them, but at least up to 11 or 12, there are already confirmation of some galaxies and this resif. This is a quite serious problem for, again, from the lambda CDN, although there are other alternative models. For instance, today we have, I think, a presentation by Gupta. He has a model, a cosmological model with a much larger age, or Melia has also a different model, which includes expansion, but the age of the universe is much larger than lambda CDN. So just to finish my presentation, my brief presentation, these are my conclusions. There are possible theoretical scenarios in which a static universe with galaxy races produced by a mechanism different from expansion or a Doppler effect is plausible. So theoretically, it's not impossible to have a static universe. Nonetheless, some observational tests favor an expanding universe rather than a static one. And the few arguments against expansion are not strong yet. They are not definitive arguments, in my opinion, to demonstrate that the universe is not in expansion. Does this mean that we can be 100% sure that the expansion of the universe is truly established beyond speculative hypotheses? I will not go so far. In cosmology, very few ideas are worth staking one's life on them. I will bet on expansion, but I think a definitive proof of it has yet to be produced. This is my conclusion. Just to finish, I recommend to people interested in this discussion of fundamental ideas in cosmology, this last book that I have published recently. Nothing else. If you have any question now in the next 5 minutes or later in the question, they are welcome. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Martin. we are running a little late. I do ask participants to try and keep their remarks to 25 minutes. I'm going to be a pretty liberal host. But so we're going to take just a few minutes for questions. Okay, Leandros, I see a hand up.
Okay, thank you for the very interesting talk. I have a question about the case of the predictions of the static universe in the context of the cosmic microwave background. What would be the mechanism by which probably a static universe would be able to reproduce the cosmic microwave background? I mean, would because you know, it's not only the temperature, which you mentioned, it's also the homogeneity and isotropy of the CMB. Is there some statement one can probably make with respect to this issue regarding using, for example, the target light or something else?
There is some literature about the CMB in a static universe, although they are toy models. It's very easy to reproduce the temperature of the CMB, the 2.7 Kelvin, with some other ideas, with the thermalization of the radiation of the galaxies and the stars, and the isotropy. But perhaps the major problem that, as far as I understand, is the shape of the black body radiation. I have not found in the literature any reference just providing a good explanation why the CMB should have a perfect black body radiation. This is a problem for alternative ideas. Nonetheless, as I said, there are some different alternative scenarios, not only for the static universe, also for other alternative cosmologies different from the Big Bang. There are many possible solutions. Also to explain the power spectrum, the power spectrum of the Planck or W map, this can be also reproduced with some alternative theories. However, it's not perfect. It's not as good as the standard model. And in my opinion, the most important difficulty, caveat, to explain the CMB is the black body shape. I don't know
because
any mechanism.
Also, you would have to explain the baryonacoustic oscillations, which are also connected to the CMB. And it's very hard to perhaps explain both of those. It's even harder. Anyway, thanks for the answer.
So just to comment, to solve the problem of old early galaxies, there are new papers that present that propose to use different feedback functions, like feedback mechanisms and all, and they change many parameters in their simulations. But those are just parameter tweaking. There doesn't seem to be any fundamental basis except to get galaxies to form very quickly. And then they claim, well, there's no problem anymore because we can fit them. But I'd like to know what you think about that, because to me it sounds it's just fitting parameters without understanding the physics of what's going on in those galaxy formation.
I totally agree with you. It's the same game that mainstream cosmology has been played during the last 40 or 50 years. It's just the ad hoc corrections. When something is not fitting the data, they try to modify, introduce the model, introducing new parameters, even if we don't understand the physics which is behind. It's just a mathematical game. Even so, there is a limit in how many parameters we can modify. And some data, for instance, this result by Steinhardt, of this recent paper, in which they show that even the galaxies can be older than the universe. There is no mechanism that can save this data. Assuming that the error bars are small enough and we can confirm these points, if these points demonstrate that the galaxies are older than the universe, of course, the galaxies cannot be formed before the Big Bang. They can form very fast, but not in negative time. So there is the sensation, and you know better than me, that there is the sensation that there are serious problems nowadays with the to say all the this age of the universe, 13.7 giga years, and the Lambda CDM as it is produced nowadays, possibly. I will expect that in the future there will be some ad hoc modification of the model just to relax the times of the formation of the galaxies and just to save again the standard the model with the new data. This has been always the game of cosmology. Every time new data are produced that demonstrate the model is wrong, the theory is changed, and with this new change they ask a new dark energy or dark energy 2 or whatever, a new dark element that produce some new change, and they are able to continue another 10 or 20 years with the cosmological model until some new data come.
Okay, last question. Thanks. Alessandro. And
yeah, hi. Yes.
Hi, Alessandro.
Remember, we're going to have a lot of time, discussion at the end of the workshop.
So don't be frustrated now, Alessandro. The point is the following. You mentioned the exotic physics, actually the dream of exotic physics by using static or non-linear theories of Heisenberg or Ehrfeld, massive theories published and demonstrated.
Everybody mute themselves to try and get rid of this echo, please.
That there is a shift, according to these established theories, between the photon, because the photon interacts with the background. The issue is different. The issue is that there is no mechanism, well-established mechanism, that assures that this interaction is necessarily towards the red. The interaction can be also towards the blue, at least locally. That is what I intended to specify. And the other issue is that we have dealt the problem classically with waves, although we have done for the correspondence principle compared to the photon, but we have not yet attacked the problem of scattering. Thank you. Just a very quick answer, to extend the comments.
And there is echo also. When I say exotic, I mean non-mainstream. Not because it is something difficult to understand in the physics or that it's impossible. No, I mean that it's non-standard. So, for instance, the idea of massive photons is something plausible, even expected from the classical electromagnetism in some sense, but it's not the standard physics assumes nowadays. We discuss later if you want.
Just a second. Second order QED is based on Euler-Heisenberg theory, born infant theory, and these are works, and they predict the shift. So no massive photo is necessary, strictly necessary.
Okay. Thank you, Alessandro. And yes, we can. I have nothing to say about that. You are the expert in the massive photons, and this for me is fine. It's not the idea accepted by most of the people. It's not because it's about something excluded from the physics that we know. It's something because it's followed by the mainstream physicists or not.
Sure, but this whole workshop is not standard.
Yes, we are not mainstream cosmologists here in this workshop, I know.